I'm just here to, express our sense of gratitude to all of you for being here, but also to say that this visit by Professor Tapati Guha-Thakurta is part of the Ahuja Family Distinguished Fellows Program at the South Asia Institute at Columbia, and this grant allows us to bring, I think possibly, two distinguished scholars, public intellectuals, writers, artists, etc., from India to come and visit Columbia and spend some time here. We had Pratap Mehta from Delhi last year, and earlier this year, well, this calendar year, we had Mahesh Dattani, the theatre director and playwright from Bombay, Bangalore, who spent time producing a play, directing a play. And now we have Professor Guha-Thakurta. So a word of thanks for the Ahuja family, particularly Mr. Sajeev Ahuja, for making this possible. With that, I will just hand you over to Professor Gayatri Spivak, who is the University Professor of Humanities at Columbia, who will introduce our speaker this evening.
Thank you, Bartho. It is a pity one always says it's a pleasure to introduce someone, because my pleasure in introducing today's speaker is real. She knows that, she should laugh away. I have known her background personally for a very long time. And more recently, since I invited her to speak at a symposium on the cultural politics of preservation in Calcutta in 2009. I had heard her before, but of course our subjects didn't coincide, so I didn't invite her until then. She gave a spectacular speech on the work in progress that has led her to her lecture and seminar for us this year. But as she well knows, the conversation on the deck of the motorboat as we went up and down the Ganga, when she pointed out with the conviction of an expert, I knew nothing, I'm just from Calcutta, that's all. She pointed out the fact that from Srirampur to Tutura, there were remains of five different imperial formations, cultural as well as material. She initiated what has become the Radiating Globality Project, embracing Africa, China, the Himalayan region, the northeastern part of Southeast Asia, and India. You realize now why I'm genuinely pleased to be able to welcome her here today. It is also true that she gave me a rousing introduction at the first meeting of the group a couple of years ago in Calcutta. And I echo her as I say a few brief words about her before she makes her remarks this evening. A star is in our midst. Tapati Guha-Thakurta is director of the celebrated Center for Studies in Social Sciences in Calcutta. She is the fall 2016, as Bartho mentioned, Ahuja Family Distinguished Fellow of Columbia. She received her BA and her MA from Presidency College and the University of Calcutta, my own college and university. Her DPhil, earned in 1988 at Oxford, was on art, artists, and aesthetics in Bengal, 1850 to 1920. Her many books include Monuments, Objects, Histories, Institutions of Art in Colonial and Post-Colonial India, 2011, published by Columbia University Press and Permanent Black in New Delhi. Her current book project is In the Name of the Goddess, the Durga Pujas of Contemporary Calcutta. She has won many important fellowships from the Getty in Los Angeles, the National Gallery in Washington, D.C., and so on. She has taught widely in 2011 at Smith College and Yale, and earlier, among many other places, at Berkeley and Jawaharlal Nehru University in New Delhi. She has considerable curatorial experience and is alive, vibrantly so, in the world of exhibitions and museums. Here she has taught a graduate seminar on rethinking the sacred objects of quote art and quote religion in contemporary India, and those quotation marks are very important, and I know precisely the ways in which she puts them there. Tonight she presents the opening lecture in a two-part series on the object flows of empire. She describes this series, this tonight's lecture, as, and I quote her, using the lens of object collecting to reflect on the interdependence and enmeshing of cultures that brought together the colonizers and the colonized and bred a milieu of cross-cultural encounters that defined the nature of early empire in British India. Our gods, their museums, as she says, is the spirit of the critique in the 80s that we launched, and this is the way in which it's really global, against that first show at the Beaubourg, Magicien de la Terre. That was our argument, our gods, their museums. Students, colleagues, friends, please welcome Tapati Guha-Thakurta.
Saying it's been a real honor to be introduced by Gayatri Dee, but also here was another origin myth that she constructed on how her radiating globality project emanated out of that trip on the Ganga that we undertook. She's been talking about that, but I must say it was a completely innocuous conversation where she remembered her trip on the Ganges several years ago when she came to immerse the ashes of her father. With your sister?
Sister. My dad died in 1955.
No, but you mentioned that's when you were last on the Ganga with your sister, right?
Maybe not. At Babuhat, yes. It's not
okay.
It
was okay. We talked about different emotional links we have with this, though the city has its back to the river. But it was a memorable day and a wonderful symposium where we did many travels, and I'll never forget taking Gayatri Dee back to Presidency College, and we had students prostrating at her. We know who this real star is here. So that was good Bengali style, you know, where, and she would be kind of saying, na 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 pranam. They would really be all there at her feet. So anyway, so thank you very much for this very warm introduction. And yes, I'm honored to be here as part of the Ahuja Family Visiting Fellow. I'm not so sure about how distinguished I am compared to those who've preceded before me. Okay. Just a few words about my talk today. Some of you I know were part of the graduate seminar where I drew much more on my existing work. I should begin by saying that at a time when a lot of history writing of a different generation is increasingly going global, thinking of comparative and connected histories, I've found, and it could be partly the demands of my job at my age, that my work has moved in an obverse direction. It's become more intensely local. You could even say parochial, so it's been focused on the city of Kolkata. So one way was because I was working doing a detailed urban ethnography of a city festival, and I wanted to get that depth of analysis by focusing on the local event, but also using this local event to think about the global portability of styles, images, cultures, and think about the global claims of a festival that is nonetheless being completely rooted in the topography of the city and in the very local worlds of its producers and organizers. Now, Calcutta's continued to remain this locus of some of the other interests that I've been pursuing since, and I thought of organizing my two lectures for Colombia, around the other interests that I've had, which is thinking about object flows, about travels and returns of objects, and about collecting, practices of collecting. So today's lecture comes out of a paper that was written up last year for an Empires and Collecting conference. And the next lecture is coming out of work that I want to pursue. And both of them are at a formative stage. I don't know how far they will travel. So the second paper will be on public statuary, but again thinking about the material transactions that lead to the making of civic statuary, particularly in the colonial period, when they were all produced elsewhere and traveled long distances here. But today's paper is on collecting. Now, two curious architectural vestiges of the early British Indian Empire in the city of Calcutta frame my study of cross-cultural collecting. The first of these, and I use the term curiosity and vestiges thinking about the ways in which this early colonial past of the city lingers still within its material remains. So I'm thinking about the ways in which the material vestiges of this past that I'll be talking about lingers within the material kind of topography of the city. The first of these vestiges is a tomb of 1828 of an Irish military officer and antiquarian collector, Charles Stewart, who served in India from 1777, rising from the ranks of a young cadet of the East India Company to that of a major general in 1814, choosing to live on in Calcutta after the end of his military service. Now, Stewart has been written about by many others with the middle name Charles Hindu Stewart, so he's featured in the work of several other scholars. But I choose to bring him into conversation with another figure, which is, I think, not been done before. Constructed in the style of a Hindu temple with turreted towers and curved arches, the image on the left, combined with an Islamic dome, Stewart's mausoleum stands deep inside what used to be called the Great Burial Ground at Chorangi. We see the entrance to that on the right. When this new European cemetery was first laid out in the 1760s, on the southern edges of the white town in a Calcutta that was fast transforming from the company's commercial hub into the capital and biggest city of the British Indian Empire. Incorporating architectural fragments from a 10th century Shaivite temple, this is an old photograph, where we see some of the sculpted heads still in place, Shiva heads still in place, which have since been removed. This structure, like the entire graveyard site, had fallen into ruins, so now you see these removed from those niches. So this entire structure, like the graveyard, had fallen into ruins until its recent renovation and conservation by the British Association for Cemeteries in South Asia, the BACSA, which is of course a very important organization which has been renovating graveyards and cemeteries across South Asia. So this is the somewhat restored site of the South Park Street Cemetery as it stands today. The other curious vestige is a grand Palladian mansion built by a Bengali merchant aristocrat, Raja Rajendra Mallik Bahadur, in the 1830s, in a narrow congested lane of Chitpur Road in the dense cluster of North Calcutta, a mansion still known by its 19th century name of the Marble Palace. Flaunting fountains, gardens, as we see here, inner courtyards, and long galleries filled with European sculpture and objets d'art. Rajendra Mullig's Palace to the Arts showcased an exuberant mix of neoclassical, rococo, and baroque styles. It was said to have been designed by an Italian architect and constructed by a vast contingent of local masons and workmen specializing in lime plaster wall decoration. So you see these still around the courtyard, the very detailed lime plaster wall decorations, which is known in Bengal as Pongherkat, and it's a kind of craftsman's tradition which has disappeared but is now being revived by several restoration architects who wish to get back to chunam and lime plaster wall. At the beginning of her book, her almost her best-selling book called Edge of Empire, Conquest and Collecting in the East, 1750 to 1850, Maya Jasanoff, wandering through the lanes of North Kolkata, stumbled upon this edifice and wondered, I quote her, what would it be like to enter imperial history through a gateway like this? What would empire look like from the inside out? It is easy to dwell on the hybrid, eclectic nature of these two architectural structures built within a decade of each other at two ends of the colonial city. A Hindu temple lookalike serving as the grave memorial of a white man in a British Christian cemetery, like we see here. And on the other hand, a European mansion becoming the home and museum of a native nouveau-riche aristocrat in a crowded and cluttered lane now filled with ruined buildings, like we see. So right flanking the marble palace is now a car garage with these strangely surreal columns, behind which the preserved building of the marble palace appears like a surreal theater set. Would it have been more apposite if these two structures were to have switched their locations in the colonial Calcutta in which they were erected? Not really. If these two structures marked out the two topographical ends of the white and the black towns of the early 19th century city, they also spoke of the porous lines that separated these two spheres of urban settlement. I'm going to show you some in two lithographs by Charles Doyle, very well known, to give you a sense of pre-photographic images of the 19th century city, and to think particularly of the close confluence of the European and Indian settlement areas. So this is the famous port and town of Kolkata, with the two figures sketching, which become very, very crucial in forms of imaging the city, and the other being this of Chitpur Road, and this is the famous Govindaram Mitra's pagoda, the black pagoda of this region, where again we see very closely the clear confluence of cultures across the divide of the white and the black town. Scholarship on the changing morphology of 18th and 19th century Calcutta has unraveled the many layers that existed within the white and black towns, and increasingly the scholarship on the 19th century city is talking about the interpenetration of the two, and the different networks that cut across the spatial boundaries of European, Armenian, Jewish, Eurasian, Muslim, Marwari, and Bengali Hindu inhabitations. At the same time, a new historiography of the early British Empire in India has repeatedly highlighted the interdependence of cultures that brought together the colonizers and the colonized, created new hierarchies of knowledge, and bred a milieu of cosmopolitan cultural encounters that thrived beneath the forces of conquest and territorial annexations. Both Charles Stuart's tomb and Rajendra Malik's palace stand as vivid testimonies to such cultural encounters and what scholars may have called crossovers. They belong to an age of empire which could look back on a thriving trend of Englishmen becoming white nawabs, emulating the lifestyles of provincial Mughal nawabs and courtiers, interning natives in their tastes, beliefs, and collecting habits. Of course, there's a vast body of literature, and the romance of the white nawab has continued through William Dalrymple's novels, I would say mostly, in his White Mughals. And Dalrymple is very much the white nawab himself, the way he lives out his life. In his dress, in his persona, he's very much become the white nawab of the time. But anyway, so this is, of course, one trajectory of Europeans turning native, and juxtaposed by Indian rulers and elite taking to the opulence of European art, architecture, furniture, and palace decor. long before they adopted to Western education and modern services and professions. So interestingly, this westernization of tastes occurs prior to even the takeover of Western education and the services. But before we typecast our two protagonists, Major General Charles Stuart and Raja Rajendra Malik within these trends, let us situate their two monuments within the specific urban surroundings in which they took their fall. Stuart's funerary monument belongs to a British cemetery, where most of the other memorials are in the shape of columns, urns, pyramids, and obelisks, with hardly a Christian cross to be detected. Robert Travers, in a wonderful essay called Death and the Nawab, talks about the funerary monuments of this period as entirely taking on the form of the late Islamic architecture. These lead us to think about how most of the British war and grave and war memorials in 18th century Calcutta grafted on the mixture of Indo-Islamic styles, one of the earliest examples, of course, being the mausoleum built in 1695 over the grave of George Chanak, the first company trader to land on the banks of the Hooghly in 1690, and set up a trading depot here, who was later given the mythical status of the founder of Calcutta. From Chanak's tomb, or the Black Hole and Rohilla War Memorials, in the city's older graveyard site, next to which was built St. John's Church in 1784. So here is the St. John's Church with the graveyard site from which we are looking out into the church. To Sir William Jones's mausoleum on the right in the South Park Street Cemetery, almost matched by William Hamilton's tomb in the St. John's Church graveyard. We find that obelisks, rotundas, towers, and minarets were very much the order of the day. It is within this mixed stylistic repertoire that Stuart's tomb takes its place, its Hindu temple form standing out against the predominance of Indo-Islamic architectural forms, but partaking in the same idioms of cultural intermixtures that signposted this phase of empire. On the converse side, Rajendra Malik's marble palace takes its place amidst a host of similar European-style mansions built over the late 18th and 19th centuries by Calcutta's new merchant elites in similar lanes and alleys branching off Chitpur Road, which was the city's oldest artery and the commercial and cultural hub of the Black Town. A political and trading agent, one of the first and grandest of these palaces was the one of Raja Navakrishna Deva Chohabajar that came up in the 1750s, several decades before the Malik Mansion, but only a few lanes away. Now I show you some contemporary photographs. These are all from Claude Campbell's 1907 book, but these are contemporary photographs of the Chohabajar Deva Mansion taken during Durga Puja when it opens up to the public as it used to in the past. And what is interesting is, of course, a new signage of the West Bengal government on the Chohabajar Rajbari. If you read it carefully, they'll talk about, there's a distinct attempt to nationalize the past, to say that there's a lot of rumors that they entertained Clive, but what people forget is they also entertained Vivekananda after his return. So there's a whole different nationalist history which they insert into the Chohabajar Rajbari. Okay. A political and trading agent to Lord Clive, Navakrishna Dev provides a typical example of the period's new generation of rich Bengali landlords and merchants who made their fortunes by collaborating with the British and securing places within the company's administration, on whom were bestowed honorific titles of Rajas and Maharajas. As has been widely discussed, the main way this upstart Indian elite could compensate for their lack of true aristocratic lineage and earn the honors of their new masters was by displaying their riches on such princely scales, by commissioning palatial residences, collecting European art objects, and hosting Oriental musical and dance soirees and lavish festival celebrations to which the British would be invited. The Shobhabajar Devs, their styles of displaying wealth and stature, and their famous banquets and gatherings would no doubt have set a model for emulation and rivalry for Rajendra Malik when he branched out from their family home at Patriyaghatta in the 1830s and planned his own European-style palace at Chorbagan, all in the same vicinities of North Kolkata. From the middle of the 18th century to the turn of the 20th, Such European style mansions of the Bengali elite would sprout on a prolific scale through the stretch of north and central Calcutta, their front columned pediments and facade jumping out of narrow streets straight off the pavement, as we see here. So there's almost no frontage, they come straight out of the streets. And these pediments and facades then leading into interiors, into courtyards and pillared platforms that served as altars for housing Hindu deities and religious ceremonies. Like the early colonial grave monuments, these elite residences too freely combined European and Indian residential architectural forms and living styles, so incorporating those Palladian frontages with the courtyard and altars within. Now in various states of decay, dilapidation, or piecemeal conservation, these Indian mansions would have competed with the monumental landscape of colonial Calcutta's new government and institutional buildings, such as the government house, the town hall, the high courts, or the Prinsep Memorial, to make Calcutta the famed city of palaces that it was, you know, even give it the name the Rome of the East. And this is a wonderful engraving of Old Courthouse Street, the government house, to see how Calcutta is located within a neoclassical setting. It could almost be a setting of Italian ruins within which the city is being located. But this is the neoclassical topography of the city. And this is, again, an image of the Prinsep Ghat, no longer today recognizable, but of course today restored, the site of music concerts, and over which now we have the new Hooghly Bridge. Okay, now, let me turn now to the particular histories of collecting that lie encapsulated within the two monuments of the early 19th century British Empire, to which I've already introduced you. What kinds of colonial subjectivities were shaped by the objects that were accumulated by figures such as Charles Stuart and Rajendra Mulli? What sense do we make of the ironic acronym of Hindu that became the middle name of Charles Stuart as a consequence of his collecting and cultural propensities? To what extent can phrases like going native or aping the West, which have been commonly used to categorize such collecting endeavors, enable us to grapple with the complexities of cross-cultural identities and encounters that were involved? For the historian Maya Jasanoff, personalities like Charles Stuart and Rajendra Mulli are classic instances of, I quote, border crossers, men who stand positioned at the edge of empire, reaching across the lines of cultural difference. In thinking about collecting as a crucial form of imperial self-fashioning, Jasanoff's key concerns are with rewriting the history of Europe's imperial expansion and engagements in India and Egypt by bringing, I quote, a human dimension to imperial history, a topic that is often treated in the abstract, whether by sweeping chroniclers of conquest or by post-colonial critics of imperial discourse. Viewed through the lens of object collecting, the nature of empire gets refracted through different frames, but its force, I would argue, in kind of contradiction to Jasanoff, seldom gets diluted or dissolved. So my concern is not to soften the contours of empire, but rather my proposition would be to pull the collecting activities of a Hindu Stuart or a Rajendra Malik away from the metaphorical edge of empire into which they've been pushed, to the center of the complex negotiations that made for life and identity in the colony, and foreground the questions of choice and agency and the links that the colonial subjects, European and Indian, forge with the metropolis. From this perspective, one of my main interests lies in marking object flows in and out of the colony and addressing the different kinds of object worlds that are constituted in the sites in which they're first gathered and displayed, or in their sites of their future dispersals. Histories of collecting we know long predate the modern age of empires and the birth of the modern institution of the museum. As they take on new forms and imperatives in the colonial and modern era, these histories often take courses that do not easily converge with the institutionalized trajectories of imperial museum collecting. In the political transition from the late Mughal Empire to the early British Empire in India, Object assemblages can be seen to grow out of multiple contexts. Gift and exchanges between court emissaries, diplomatic transactions between commercial and political agents, plunder and rewards of conquest, travels and explorations, antiquarian and scholarly discoveries, or even acquisition on the open market. Over the course of the late 18th and 19th centuries, the routes of object circulations moved back and forth between the provincial Indian courts and princely states to the trading depots, military garrisons, residencies, and presidency towns of British India. What would be the changing registers of rights and legitimacies in accessing objects? How do new desires of art collecting and museum making inflect these processes? And what are the accidents of preservation or dispersal that make or unmake the futures of these collections? It is with this set of questions that I'd like to take up in greater detail my two case studies of cross-cultural collecting and see how different prehistories of the modern institution of the museum are thrown open in colonial Calcutta by Major General Stewart's first, I quote, Oriental Museum of Hindu Sculptures, and by Rajendra Mullick's display of his collection as, I quote, the country's first museum of Western art. Now, the first section is called Hindu Stewart and his Hindu Gods. It's hard to gauge what may have driven Stewart's growing obsession with Hindu rituals and ceremonies and his scouring of temple sites for worshipped or abandoned sculpted figures in the areas of the Bengal Presidency, where he wandered in his capacity as an army officer. What is clear, though, is that his passion for owning local religious imagery had little to do with the contemporary world of Orientalist scholarship on classical Indian languages, scripts, and texts, represented by late 18th century scholars such as Nathaniel Holhead, Colebrook, Charles Wilkins, of course, most famously, William Jones, and his patron, Warren Hastings, and their setting up of the Asiatic Society of Bengal in Calcutta in 1784. Now, this image of Hastings is a wonderful tableau of Orientalist scholarship of the time, with his Brahmin Pandit and his Muslim Ulema and the worlds of Oriental scholarship. Now, in the South Park Street Cemetery, the funerary monuments of William Jones and Charles Stewart stand within a few yards of each other, the towering white obelisk and the domed temple, each connoting the intense engagement of the interned subjects with the cultural worlds of the colony they had made their home. But they also remind us of the two sharply separated worlds of the colonial Indophiles of the time. William Jones, a judge of the Calcutta High Court, a renowned expert on Persian and Sanskrit, founder of the Asiatic Society, was the period's archetypal scholar bureaucrat, pioneering, as we know, a new trend of philological and textual scholarship. At the other end of the spectrum were maverick antiquarians like Charles Stewart, meandering from his career in the army into his deep engagements, entanglements, I would say, with Hindu religious objects and customs, but with no accredited claims of scholarship over the subjects of his fascination, nor with any legitimate status as a collector. The name Hindu that his detractors sardonically attached to him seemed to have sprung from an anonymous pamphlet that he published in two parts in 1808 titled A Vindication of the Hindus. The first part being a rebuttal of, I quote, the aspersions of Reverend Claudius Buchanan. The second part a combined reply to comments in the magazine Christian Observer of Mr. Fuller, Secretary to the Baptist Missions Society, and to a sermon preached in Oxford by Reverend Dr. Barrow on the expediency of introducing Christianity among the natives of India. It was a battle against the propaganda zeal of Christian missionaries and the calumny they heaped on the religion of the natives of India that became the main grounds of Stewart becoming Hindu. He himself writes, "My judgments of things Hindu have fallen short of my zeal in the cause I had undertaken to defend." One could surmise it was the urgency of the defense that produced the excess of his zeal that led him to personally accumulate a large body of statuary from various temple sites that he visited, to push his way, as rumored, into Hindu public ceremonies where he would hardly have been welcome, and to even take on a construction of a temple on Sagar Island on the Bay of Bengal. But you know, none of these survive. And in fact, there's no even photograph for, there's no painting of Hindu stone that I've even been able to look at. The Baptist missionary John Chamberlain, with whom Stuart was engaged in a fierce diatribe, openly labeled him an idol stealer. If he could not purchase an image that took his fancy, it was reported, he sometimes took it by force, often surreptitiously in the dead of night, using as his henchmen two Brahmins who would remove objects and guard his trophies at home. There can be little doubt that Stuart's acquisition incurred the wrath of the powerful lobby of temple priests of Bhubaneswar, even as they invited the strong censure of his compatriots, not just British missionaries like Chamberlain, but also Orientalist scholars like James Prinsep and early archaeological explorers like Markham Kitto. When Prinsep discovered in 1810 that two inscribed slabs that Charles Stuart had presented from his possessions to the Asiatic Society had been cut out of the walls of a 10th century temple of Bhubaneswar, he instructed Kitto to return these to the site. And when Kitto did so, he was confronted by irate priests who then presented him with a long list of other stolen images by Stuart, whose return they also insisted upon. So Kitto writes he wished he had never embarked on this project at all. Now, but I would still ask, how do we position Charles Stuart's collecting practices in the colonial milieu of his times? The question that particularly befuddled me was, what would have made his modes of acquisition of objects any less proper or legitimate than the ways in which manuscripts, folios of miniature paintings, armory and royal regalia, coins, inscriptions, and other archaeological artifacts were being procured in the late 18th century by large numbers of his European contemporaries? How would Stuart have transgressed the prevailing parameters of treasure hunting and collecting antiquities at a time when the steady infiltration of European presence in Indian provincial courts had opened up many avenues of transactions through courtiers and dealers, and when the country's vast landscape of historical temples and archaeological sites lay unprotected, serving as free grounds of spoliation of both colonial explorers and local feudatories? The books of Richard Davis, Lives of Indian Images, Maya Jasanoff, Edge of Empire, and Natasha Eaton's book called Mammoths Across Empires have closely delved into these myriad worlds of art and antiquarian collecting in late Mughal and early British India that enabled prolific flows of objects out of Indian courts, towns, and archaeological sites and made for the earliest museum collections in India and England. So the figure that immediately comes to mind is, of course, Colonel Anton Poulier, a French mercenary at Nawab Asafuddola's court in Awadh, who grew into an avid connoisseur and collector of manuscripts and paintings, commissioned a book on Hinduism, and enjoyed the honors of sending across to Europe the first full set of manuscripts on the Sanskrit Vedas. He's been the subject of a lot of writing by Sanjay Subramaniam, also by Seema Alavi, who's translated his writing. And by posing with his cohort of friends and Indian servants and dealers in the Lucknow studio of the visiting artist John Zofani, Poulier provided also the perfect tableau vivant of European social life and collecting in early colonial India. This is also the time when Colonel Colin Mackenzie, who in 1817 would take on the post of the first Surveyor General of India, traveled through southern and central India with a Tamil Brahmin Pandit and a Muslim scribe as his aides, drawing, documenting, and freely helping himself to temple inscriptions, sculpted figures, architectural remains, and manuscripts, some of which came into the Asiatic Society and later the Indian Museum in Calcutta, and the bulk of which came to form the Mackenzie Archives in London's Indian Museum. Where in this milieu then lays towards perceived audacity in the manner in which he collected his Hindu antiquities? There were others before him who had acquired a scattering of Hindu religious sculpture at a time when they were generally regarded as monstrous heathen gods. On the western coast, we are told, the Orientalist scholar James Forbes was gifted on the eve of his departure from India with a selection of Hindu temple antiquities, which he transported back to England and set up around a temple-like structure in a sculpture garden in his country estate. Stuart's successes, one may surmise, came out of his insistence on worship, acquiring worship images from active temple sites, his forced removals, and the tendencies of his henchmen to pull out carvings and figures from temple walls. Few of the objects he acquired would presumably have met the latterly archaeological category of movable antiquities, that is, fallen structures or loose sculpted fragments that could be legitimately moved off-site to museums in the interest of safe custody. And this is something I've written about in my earlier work, that what constituted the objects of museum collecting and what was this category of movable antiquity that could be legitimately moved off-site into museums. Presumably none of what Stuart collected would have fitted that category. Stuart's stepping beyond norms also seemed to lie in the zeal with which he had taken to the customs of the Hindus. To don the costumes of a Nawab, to take on one or more native wives and breed a half-native family was a common enough propensity for colonial officers and civilians during this phase of East India Company's rule. And this is one of the many portraits we have of the Bibis. This is Jamdani Bibi of William Hickey. Hindu Stuart was said to have gone many steps further in that he allowed his Hindu wife to make, I quote, a Hindu of him, in that he used to offer pujas to idols and worship the Ganges, and even took to feeding 100 beggars daily. Yet we are also told that it was with the specific intention of setting up a house museum that he gathered his vast array of large and small sculptures, lintels and door jams, and decorated friezes. Given the generic label of Hindu sculptures in a later Christie's auction catalogue of 1830, the collection in Stuart's home in Calcutta would have consisted of Hindu, Jain, and Buddhist figures in black schist and basalt, occasionally in metal or terracotta, belonging primarily to the Pala and Sena period sites of Bihar and Bengal of the 9th to 11th century, and to the Orissa temples of the 11th to 13th centuries. Now, what I'm showing you are all from a British Museum site where ultimately Stuart's collection travels. So this is from there that I'm trying to reconstruct what they would have, his house museum would have consisted of. Culled from temples, fields, and river banks, these objects in Stuart's home had entered a liminal zone where they were not quite gods and not quite works of art, referred to, interestingly, as his trophies over which two Brahmin aides stood guard. These objects were set into the outer and inner walls of his home in Wood Street, off Park Street, Calcutta, where visitors would be shown around and new purchases sought after. So he was seen like very much of an art dealer in his own time, where he was both inviting new objects and, you know, getting his own things evaluated. The form of display with figures and slabs incorporated into the body of the structure would have made the house a place in between a temple and a museum. We have unfortunately no drawings or prints conjuring the image of the house, but we could think of the place as being similar to the kinds of house museums that we see in other parts of India. Say this one, set up several decades later in the 1870s by the collector of Patna, A.M. Broadley, with largely the same genre of medieval Eastern Indian sculptures. Taking on the formal appellation of the Bihar Museum of Bihar Sharif, Broadley's home museum remained the main repository of the archaeological finds of the region until the museum was dismantled and his collection transferred to the Indian Museum in Calcutta at the end of the 19th century. Stuart's house museum too would be pulled apart soon after his death on 31st March 1828, with no surviving traces in today's Calcutta. Stuart was already planning the shipment of his collection to England, and in 1827 had delayed his cold weather voyage to England to the next season, by which time he had hoped to arrange for this transportation. When death intervened a few months later, the man who had turned Hindu was given a Christian burial, but with architectural and sculptural fragments from its collection incorporated into his temple-like funerary monument. So there was actually architectural kind of edifice that was transported from his home museum into the funerary monument, which we looked at. To quote Richard Davis, this was Stuart's parting provocation to his old enemies, the missionaries. The missionaries struck back when his Wood Street house, by then denuded of most of its objects except the few that could not be extricated from the walls, was acquired by the London Missionary Society in 1829. So I think that his house became the center of the Missionary Society. By then, Hindu Stuart's entire collection had been packed and shipped to England in 143 cartons, where barring 15 items that he had donated to the East India Company's India Museum, his heirs in England put up the remaining 154 objects from his collection for sale at a Christie's auction in London on 15 June 1830. I'll briefly return at the end of the paper to the London story of the sale, display, and later acquisition of the by the British Museum of the Stuart collection, and its retrospective fame as the first, and I quote, greatest collection of Indian sculpture ever put together by an individual collector to come into a Western museum. Within a decade of the dismantling of Hindu Stuart's Oriental Museum in Wood Street, in the dense native quarters of Chorbagan, a teenage Rajendra Mullick took on the construction of one of the city's grandest Palladian mansions, which we've already seen. Here it is again, in which he would create his fanciful palace to the arts. There are many parallels and contrasts to be thought through. Like Charles Stuart, Rajendra Mullick also planned his mansion to be a museum and not just a private residence, and offered its collection for the edification of public tastes. If Stuart's appropriated remains of Hindu temple architecture and sculpture were audaciously implanted into the heart of the White Town, the Mullick Mansion was constructed in a portion of the family estate at Chorbagan, where the young Rajendra's father, Babu Nilmoni Mullick, had built and consecrated the family's Vaishnav shrine, the Thakur Bati, dedicated to the deity Jagannathji. It is here, over 12 cleared out acres of land, that he built up his European style salon and mansion that would later be given the name Marble Palace by Viceroy Lord Minto at the turn of the 20th century. In the context of its christening with this new name, The Empire, the Calcutta Evening Newspaper of 16th March 1909, referred to the palace as, I quote, internally and externally, architecturally and artistically, one of the finest Indian residences in Calcutta, whose treasures carefully preserved within admirably fulfill the art lover's eager expectancy. What the report found most surprising is that despite being in existence for several decades, both the palace and its contents are almost unknown to the European population of Calcutta, although its gates are never closed and everybody is ever welcome to enter. It is fair to assume here that if few Europeans were interested in visiting the Mullick Palace, there were equally few Indians who would have wandered into Stuart's house museum to marvel at his assemblage of Hindu antiquities. Here, then, were two closely bordering worlds of collecting and display, Western and Indian, each simulating the other, each staging its crossing of cultures, yet each also effectively sealed off from each other. Foremost of the period's new merchant elites, emerging out of the trading caste of the Subarna Bunniks of early medieval ancestry, the Mullicks made their wealth in the 18th century in the banking business and in the overseas bullion and sugar trade. Biographers of the Mullick family present Rajendra's father Nilmoni Mullick as a pious and philanthropic Hindu whose main attainments lay in the many temples, bathing embankments, almshouses, and dispensaries he funded, and in the large-scale feeding of mendicants and poor pilgrims he would host at his establishments in Puri and Calcutta. It is interesting to reflect here on how Stuart, in becoming Hindu, had also taken to similar acts of poor feeding and philanthropy. When Nilmoni Mullick Sandi died in 1821 at the age of 46, he left behind a widow and an adopted 3-year-old son, Rajendra, both of whom, following a civil suit, and the partitioning of the family's ancestral property at Bathuriyaghatta, moved to stay in the precincts of the family temple at Cholbagan, which is the one, this is the one. The infant son was placed by the court of wards under the guardianship of a British barrister, Sir James Weir Hogg, in whom was invested the charge of the family estate till Rajendra achieved adulthood. Now this is of course happening in the case of several of these families. The building of the grand European style mansion was the mark of Rajendra Mullick's coming of age. When side by side with maintaining his father's religious charities and his tradition of Persian and Sanskrit scholarship, he acquired his English education at Hindu College and carefully honed his image as a westernized gentleman. The flamboyance of his wealth was complemented by his cultivation of knowledge in Hindustani classical music and Western fine arts, in natural history, botany, ornithology, and zoology. And in keeping with both the museum and private European collecting fashions of the time, Rajendra Mullick expanded his field of collecting from clocks, curios, vases, pianos, chandeliers, sculpture, paintings, and prints, to even rare specimens of birds and animals, which he assembled in a menagerie that spilled over from the gardens and ponds to the inner courtyard of the villa. So you still see the birds inside. The perceived excesses of Charles Stuart's obsession with things Hindu stand contrasted here, and I'd like to underline this point, by the easy acceptability in contemporary social circles of Rajendra Mullick's balancing of his orthodox Hindu pieties and composition of religious hymns with his modern learning and westernized artistic tastes. While Stuart, in turning Hindu, was seen by his contemporaries to have transgressed the limits of going native, Rajendra Mullick, it seems, could flaunt his Western palace and its Western art collection without forfeiting the security and sanctity of his Hindu self. His acts of public benefaction extended to the improvement of the locality of Cholbagan, where he offered the government several plots of land from his estate for the opening of new roads leading to his palace. But in no way could the alleys of this North Calcutta locality be transformed into a grand avenue fit for such an edifice. So the Empire, the Calcutta Evening News, reported in 1809 that it was always as a hidden palace that it sprung into view. This is a contemporary view, that one discovered, I quote, within a stone's throw of the grimy, bustling Chitpur Road, what one may aptly describe as the Burlington House of Calcutta. So this is the Evening News writing in 1909. From then until now, visitors have never ceased to be amazed by the oddity of this 19th century palace to the arts in the dingy location that it inhabits. The vast collection that one encounters inside was acquired during the 1860s and 70s, by which time Rajendra Mullick would have won his honorific aristocratic titles of Rai Bahadur and Raja from Lord Lytton, and become a member of the city's erudite circle of trustees of the Asiatic Society and the Indian Museum. The architecture and the extravagance of the objects it houses are intended to overwhelm the senses. So I'm going to take you through a quick journey. As we enter through the long colonnaded carriage porch, through the billiard and banquet rooms, into the inner courtyards with relief sculptures and standing marble statuary. So here is the Durga Puja altar with the Diana hunting the stags relief at the back. These are the kind of marble sculptures. Many of these are from Trocadero, and they're clearly copies that are traveling all over. And we come then to this inner bedazzling cornucopia of European antique furniture, decor, bric-a-brac, and art objects. Belgian glass mirrors and windows, Venetian chandeliers and candelabra, massive Chinese porcelain vases and a Burmese urn, floors designed with elaborate mix of mosaics, and most of all, rows and rows of classical, neoclassical sculpture and busts on pedestals and walls, thickly lined with framed prints and paintings. Here is a classic example of how India collected Europe. This is one of innumerable such instances that the period offers of a tendential reversal of roles, whereby the colony emerges from being the lands from where vast bodies of Oriental riches and objects are searched out and collected into a site where an equally vast corpus of European decorative luxury and fine art objects poured in shipments over the 19th century to fill the stores of auction houses, dealers, and traders, and from where they were ordered and acquired by several Indian courts, palaces, and many such wealthy homes. Raja Rajendra Mallick, who's alone said to have amassed almost all that is today in the Marble Palace, never traveled abroad for collecting, nor did he need to. It is instructive to think how, without moving outside the bounds of mid-19th century Calcutta, he could acquire and fine-tune his taste for European salon art of the period. In the city itself, he could order his choice of Belgian and Venetian mirrors and chandeliers, have local artisans work with European designers on elaborate architectural ornamentation and sculpted decor, and liberally pick and choose from the available selection of statuary, paintings, and prints of Italian, French, Flemish, or British schools, all of which were being supplied by salons in and ateliers in largely in Italy. So in fact, many of these salons are operating out of Florence and supplying the kind of the salons all over the world. It was famed that his collection came to include even an original Titian, a Rubens, and a Reynolds, although the provenance of such originals in the collection have been heavily contested. Both the claims to own originals and the rubbishing of these claims are definitely latter-day developments. For in that period, copies of neoclassical paintings by European artists by studios specializing in this work were valued in their own right and coveted by Indian collectors like European collectors too. Okay, so some of the paintings in the Marble Palace, such as Rubens' Marriage of St. Catherine, or say Reynolds' Infant Hercules and the Serpent, we know exist simultaneously in several other palace collections, which means there were several copies of these circulating. Such as many other palace collections would have the same painting, such as that owned by Dwarakanath Tagore in the Belgachia Villa, or that accumulated by Jyotirindra Mohan Tagore in the 1880s in the special Scottish-style turreted castle he commissioned in the middle of Pathriyakhata. So this was called the Tagore Castle. Its facade is completely destroyed now. But this was his Scottish castle, which he built in the heart of North Calcutta, and which hosted one of the biggest Western art collections of the time. There are fascinating collecting histories to be unraveled here, and innumerable networks of collectors and dealers to be searched out. There are art objects that traveled to Calcutta from ateliers like those of Signor Pompignoli and Carlendi in Florence that produced copies of European antique sculpture and paintings of old masters for sale throughout the world. Art dealing firms in Calcutta like D. Rosario and Company that brought in shipments of fine engravings and copies of Victorian paintings for dealers and auctioneers. Okay, and many of these paintings we find also then travel between different collections. They move from European art schools to and exhibitions in the city to rich homes, and then were often traded between these homes as the wealth and fortunes fluctuated and tastes for art collecting shifted to Oriental and Indian works of art. So for instance, I follow the case of, say, a painting like this, which was clearly acquired by the Awadh court of Wajid Ali Shah, and which then traveled to initially the Mahatab families in Vardhaman, and was later gifted to Curzon when he set up the Victoria Memorial. So we have this kind of traveling artworks within the city and within Bengal itself. As against the growing interest in colonial collecting and exhibiting of Indian art objects, these concomitant histories of the circulation and consumption of European art furniture and interior decor among the colonial Indian elite has hardly drawn any interest, nor the stories of how these collections came to also include many academic portraits, life studies, and landscapes by 19th century Indian artists whose name stands obscured in Indian art history. As a new age of nationalism redefined the scopes of modern Indian art practice and made the nation's own art traditions the sole focus of the new discipline of Indian art history, these other worlds of westernized artistic tastes and propensities systematically fell from grace and were given the tags of derivative, imitative, and un-Indian. And today, hardly any of these great home collections survive to have their stories told. Their sole historical traces remaining in the few printed catalogs and inventories that are occasionally available. The Marble Palace's main claim to distinction today, then, is that it is the only carefully conserved example of its kind from the colonial city that had once hosted so many such palatial mansions and similar object assemblages. Its one-of-a-kind status is underlined by its survival amidst the decay of many other such aristocratic properties around it. Its rarity lies also in the way it has kept to the mandate of its founder and propelled its own transformation into a public museum with the support of the West Bengal state government, which free but restricted access, you can actually buy tickets and enter it, and there are very strict prohibitions, of course, against photography. That most of the other properties, like the Marble Palace, fell into dispute, decay, and shambles, and that all collectible and saleable objects within them were indiscriminately dispersed over the mid and late 20th century by antique and art dealers, makes the will to self-preservation and museumization of the Malik Palace all the more singular. It was Rajendra Malik's eldest grandson, Nagendra Malik Bahadur, who said to have added to the art collections of the Marble Palace and to have catalogued the whole collection in honour of the visit of Viceroy and Lady Minto in March 1910, but there are no published records of this catalogue. It was the seventh generation Malik who published in 1976 a small catalogue of the collection, one that lists only the artworks, that is only the paintings and sculpture, not the other objects, and is no longer available. And it's a ninth generation Malik, a young lawyer called Brotindra Malik, who takes the initiative now in hiring out this front courtyard and banquet hall to select conference and cultural embassy parties, where he and his family play out their role as hosts in period costume and take guests on a limited conducted tour of the courtyard with one or two inner rooms. Conclusion. Yet all said, Marble Palace standing as India's first museum of Western art is easily scoffed at. Art historians find here more second-rate reproductions and pompous pretensions than any true samples of art or antiquities. And museum experts are bound to find this a curious, somewhat tacky, and indiscriminately stuffed version of a 19th century European salon. So it is with this white but not quite identity, and is never to be resolved as a museum and an art collection, that I like to juxtapose today's Marble Palace with today's high artistic rating and art historical credentials of the collection of Eastern Indian medieval sculpture that found their way from Charles Stewart's holding into the British Museum to form its core South Asian collection. An ironic reversal of value and status are sharply played out in the changing afterlives of the two collections I've discussed. In the post-independence years, it becomes increasingly difficult to take seriously the praise heaped by the colonial and Indian nationalist press at the turn of the 20th century on the Malik Palace Art Gallery, as I quote, a unique art collection in which every Bengali ought to take pride. Now, this came to me as a surprise because here we already have the nationalization of modern Indian art, but the Indian Mirror is still writing, I quote, those who think that Hindus have no taste for art will find their mistake on a visit to the late Rajendra Malik's art palace, which is without exaggeration one of the best that can be seen in India. While one genuine Hindu was being feted by his fellow Bengalis for proving their taste for art, another non-genuine Hindu had been berated in his time by his European peers for his very lack of artistic taste and for the impropriety of his acquisitions. It becomes important to remember that in the time they were acquired and placed on display in his house, Charles Stewart's hoarding of sculptures commanded none of the prestige and legitimacy of an art collection that was being accorded to objects in the Malik Palace even a century later at the height of Indian nationalism. The late 19th and early 20th century would see a gradual retrospective reappraisal of Stewart's role as a collector of Indian sculpture and of the artistic worth of the objects he acquired. In the early 20th century, around the time that Rajendra Malik's Palace to the Arts was still being lauded as the city's best art gallery, a Bengali archaeologist, Ramaprasad Chondo, was turning his scholarly attention on the British Museum's collection of medieval sculpture from Eastern India and Burma, tracing its lineage back to Charles Stuart's House Museum in Kolkata, and writing one of the first investigative articles on this forgotten worthy and his tomb in the South Park Street Cemetery. So it's this Ramaprasad Chandu article written in the 1920s that in a way set me on this trail. Shipped to his heirs in England after his death, the Stuart collection would travel through different sales and owners before it had, I quote, the amazing good fortune of being gifted to the trustees of the British Museum. The 154 items that the first Christie's auction of 15 June 1830 put on sale in London was said to represent only a part of his extensive Oriental Museum. So again, I go back to some of the objects that made up his Oriental Museum. Stuart's will listed several other objects in his collection, armory, ritual vessels, painting, manuscripts, whose later destinations remain unknown. With few bidders, the bulk of the sculptures at the Christie auctions were purchased in 1830 by a British businessman with India connections, who, like Stuart, had these sculptures incorporated with the architecture of his suburban residence at Shepherd's Bush outside London. So we have Stuart's Hindu gods moving from one Englishman's home in Wood Street, Calcutta, to another Englishman's mansion on the outskirts of London, John Bridges Woodhouse, where they remained for over four decades in the custody of the Bridge family, once again a source of wonder and curiosity for all visitors and passers-by. But again, could not acquire any photographs of even the Shepherd's Bush house, where these sculptures were actually built into the mansion itself. In the Shepherd's Bush home, these sculptures also began to attract the interests of artists and connoisseurs as specimens of antique sculptures belonging to the ancient Eastern religions of Buddhism, Jainism, and Hinduism. When Woodhouse went up for sale in 1872, and its collections awaited an urgent dispersal, it was in this new capacity as ancient Indian sculpture that these objects caught the attention of Augustus Wollaston Franks, the dynamic keeper of antiquities of the British Museum. The date for a second auction had been set in June 1872, when Franks persuaded the Bridge family to gift this entire collection of sculptures to the British Museum, paying a nominal sum of £500 for the dismantling and transportation of the objects. So essentially, they were donated and they only paid for the dismantling and transportation. Labeled the Bridge Collection, this founding hall of Indian sculpture at the British Museum would steadily grow in its artistic stature over the course of the 20th century. While museum curators drew back its history and provenance to the collections amassed in Calcutta by Hindu Stuart, they no longer dwelt, interestingly, on the alleged illegitimate means of their acquisition. Unlike the legacy of the founder Raja Rajendra Malik, which continues to fuel the pride and prestige of his descendants in the Marble Palace collection, Hindu Stuart has remained a more difficult genealogy to accommodate within a mega institution of world culture like the British Museum. His image cleansed and his collections rendered into art of the highest order, Stuart's controversial Hindu past now stands subtly effaced from the objects he appropriated and owned. In his own time, the eccentric Major General was alleged to be always setting a far higher value on his collected objects than was ever their due. This is the report of the Times. Their belated vindication and museum life as the finest specimens of early Indian sculpture would have left him bewildered, perhaps scornful, or even a little amused. Just as the reversal of the artistic status of his collection and the Marble Palace quick fall from grace as Calcutta's best art gallery would have left Rajendra Malik shocked and fuming. Together, they would have been left reflecting about the unintended destinies of the objects they had gathered, about the treacherously shifting grounds of artistic taste, and about the contingencies of dispersals and preservations that have determined the afterlives of these collections. Thank you.
Some questions.
up some of the stuff that I have written in your theory. Okay, now, how am I going to do this? Okay, I will say Lenny first, then Manan, and then Shambhog.
We need a microphone in this room. We've had numerous.
For the recording.
I saw a few Indian paintings, I think, in the Malik House. What I wondered was, were there any collectors who collected both Indian and Western, and who had some aesthetic sense about in doing that?
As I mentioned, there were works of Indian, what you would call academic style artists, certainly. So the collections would have included works by those Indian artists who were trained in oil painting and who would be doing landscapes, portraits, even history paintings. So you do have a Ravi Verma, for instance, in the Marble Palace, but it's not the pride of their collection, let me put it this way. So they would have entered. Certainly some of the portraits in the European style, like in even in Jorashako, would have been done by Indian artists being trained in oil painting and portraiture. Now, this mix of tastes that you're talking about, now, very interestingly, a lot of these houses had absolutely similar kinds of artworks. As I said, there was nothing exceptional about Marble Palace except its will to preservation and its kind of transformation into this museum of Western art in a capacity in which it continues even today. Now, one of the houses that I came across, and much of this work I did 30 years ago when I was working on my PhD thesis and trying to think of what we call westernization is not something that was confined to art schools, but something that infiltrates tastes and practices both at the popular level and at the level of elite kind of tastes. And I wandered around several of these collections, many of which no longer exist. And I did come across collections that, for instance, acquired a lot of Chinese, particularly Far Eastern art. So here's an interesting example of how Oriental and Western art comes together. The Chinese and Japanese material were largely porcelain vases, not paintings. I think the 1911 revolution and the Sun Yat-sen break meant huge amounts of Chinese objects traveled to India. So yes, you know, that is a whole history that has not been written about and would be very difficult to reconstruct. But in most cases, and the Jorashako Tagore house becomes typical, that once Oriental tastes or Indianized tastes come in, this was considered art to be dispersed. So Havel, within the art school, dispersed all the copies of European neoclassical art, which were used as teaching aids. The story is he dumped them in a pool at the back. I think that is apocryphal. Probably he sold them. And we know that the Jorashako family sold a lot of its European portraits and sculpture, which was acquired by the Maliks. They are absolutely next to each other. So in fact, now when you go to a tour, you're shown the bad tastes of the Maliks, and then you're shown Jorashako, which is the heart of the Bengal Renaissance. So that is your classic tour now of that part. So yes, I would have said that in most cases, if you turned to things Indian, which the Tagore household did, you dispensed of this. But some of them show that there is, of course, Persian and certainly Far Eastern material coming into these collections. So one could think about a certain kinds of eclectic taste, but then I would say Chinese vases and porcelain somewhere seem to fit this model of antique collecting.
Thank you so very much. That was an amazingly sort of rich and generative talk. I'm speaking from outside the discipline, so please forgive me. But I wanted to ask you about two things. One, you mentioned sort of you made a connection between William Jones and the Charles, the Hindu steward. And I'm wondering if you can locate the Napoleon Scientific Exhibition and the collection of both objects and texts and the founding of Louvre, you know, as sort of a way to think about these two individuals and what is happening, both in the terms of textual philological collection and then the type of object collection that you have detailed. And my second question is with regards to the Mahal. I spent a little bit of time in Bahawalpur, where the Bahawalpur Noor Mahal, which was built in 1870, also in a neoclassical mode with Italian frescoes, and is abandoned. So, I mean, it's still standing, but it's you can't go inside unless you have connections. But there, in some of my conversations with one or two descendants of that family, the local, their understanding for why it looked Italian neoclassical was that they said that this was Goronki Jannat. So there was an idea of paradise that the Nawab was trying to reimagine. So the garden and the statues were thinking about how the Farangi Jannat might look like in the 1870s. I don't know what to make of it, but I'm wondering if you can speak about if there are any conceptual concepts behind the sort of accumulation of these objects. Thank you.
I think your second bit, you know, that there were European architects and Italian architects particularly were in great demand. So what you say makes me think about Lucknow and Awadh, particularly in the early 19th century, which is like open, one of the kind of greatest grounds for the efflorescence of early European tastes and styles, and which is happening in the same time that the Marble Palace is being constructed. And so you hear the names of a lot of Italian architects who are clearly there, you know, and they would have been like your, you know, French and Italian collectors, mercenaries, and architects who are there. And like your traveling European artists, I think the Indian courts would have hosted several of these. So, and when you, of course, Metcalf was following the career then of the Indo-Saracenic palace building styles, he's looking at, of course, mainly British architects then, and he's looking at the ways in which these styles and how they take on Saracenic modes. So yes, in terms of this notion, and I'm thinking of some of the, well, apart from Claude Martin's La Martinière, which is this huge, this excessive mansion in the middle of early 19th century Awadh. And so it's like almost bordering the Husseinabad, you have all this. There's a huge kind of spread of this kind of architecture. So I would say that what one can trace in the streets of North Calcutta would have been a common pattern. You don't see it in Bombay. In Bombay, there's a very, very different order of the Victorian Gothic in a much more planned way under Batley and others that would kind of later take over. So it's a much more planned program. So I would say this kind of deep penetration of Europe, taste for European architectural form. And this idea that of paradise would be interestingly played out, because I'm sure, because if the Europeans were interested in Mughal and late Mughal architecture because it appealed to their sense and sensibilities, so similarly I would have said that this kind of drawing on, you know, European models would have been part of that taste and sensibilities of, I would say, the later provincial Mughal styles. I mean, there is, of course, that element even in Mughal architecture. One is talking about, you know, blends there. But certainly over the 18th century, that would have become an important trope. So I would say that that idea that you would have, and particularly once you move from the forts into city palaces, which I think is happening in all the princely states, The cultivation of European styles within, and of course by the late 19th century, they're coming within much more structured kind of modes of the Islamic styles too, would have been completely within part of the tastes and self-fashioning of the time. I haven't followed these architectural histories very much, but I would say that therefore what you're speaking about seems to be perfectly within a certain, you know, trope and trajectory one can recognize. Now, on the worlds of collecting, now, I do talk about, yeah, while the Jones and the Asiatic Society, there's a particular world of Oriental scholarship, which is about, and manuscript collecting is an important part of it. Now, what struck me was that how Hindu Stuart was never a part of that circle at all. I mean, he was completely on the margins of that circle, which is why the few items he does give later, to Princep and then through Princep to the Asiatic Society and Museum, is accepted. But I don't think his world, and I'm just surmising, his worlds and William Jones's world would have automatically come together. I mean, they're both Indophiles, and I'm trying to think. So one becomes the deviant Hindu in terms of the excesses, but also because somewhere, and that is interesting, his collecting and acquisition is continuously being seen to be invasive. It is not follow, and nor does it partake of the worlds of philological textual. So they're constantly saying that he has no clue about the provenance of his sculptures. I mean, he's collect. So, you know, trying to reconstruct his collecting activity of Stuart has always been retrospective. It is because that they happen to find their way, and latter day, and it's under Bridge collection, and then they're traced to Hindu Stuart, that one is talking about them. So I'm only surmising that if there were much more defined structures of Orientalist scholarship, acquisition, and collecting, and in which many Indians would then have been inducted. So one of the figures I wrote on was Rajendralal Mitra, and how his antiquarian collecting both was with archaeological objects, but also manuscripts. And the kind of resistance they face from pandits and monasteries and many other places to that kind of collecting. So Hindu Stuart's collecting, it seemed to be, never quite met the standards of legitimacy and propriety that seems to, even in the late 18th century mode. And I'm asking the question when one is asking what is propriety at this time, right? When the archaeological survey is always talking about the time of open pillaging of antiquities, right? So those writing a latter-day history of archaeology will always look back on this past as part of rampant open spoliation and pillaging. And yet within that, Stuart has been pushed even more to the edge as this deviant form. So this is what I'm thinking. So whether there would have been conversations between his collecting and what was happening in the circles of the Asiatic Society seems, I mean, given the diatribe against him, and I think it was partly his own long battles he was fighting out with the missionaries that could have pushed him, could have also been the mods through which he was angering, as he said, these temple priests who talked about them. That would have pushed him into the margins. So I don't have a clearer answer, except that I like to think that the two worlds did not quite overlap in the way we would think.
Thank you, Tapati, for the talk. This was a very nostalgic trip in the last 1 hour. I was thinking basically about this idea of eclectic taste and how a longer history of taste can be, you know, thought of from this material that we have, particularly at the level of collecting, but also at the level of comportment, because we see both
at the level of
comportment. Yeah, because we see both Charles Stuart and Rajendra Mulli striving to become something by collecting. And also by acquiring certain behavioral traits and practices, which form a larger world of practices. So, and to me, it seems that when Stuart would think of Mullik's practice, or Mullik would think of Stuart's practice, they would have very different opinion of one another, while Stuart almost had, it is like having no sense of refinement in that sense of the term, and Mullik striving for a particular refinement. And this idea of taste then gets, I mean, with the larger history of the objects traveling to different, through different spaces, we have people who are purchasing, people who are commissioning, and then people who are researching on them. So there's both this etic idea of taste and an emic sense of taste for people who research on this, and then, I mean, completely say that the marble palace is not really a museum in that sense of the term. It's almost like a menagerie, so without any logic of itself. So this is something that I was thinking, how would then one speak of a logic of taste in this rather eclectic world of collecting and, you know, visiting oneself by behavioral practices?
You know, just a short response. I mean, yours was a larger reflection on how we understand these worlds of transculturations that we can think about and object flows within it. Now, I would say that each of these collections would have worked with their own very inner tight logic. A logic that may not translate into what today we may think of as a high quality art collection and what gallery displays are meant to look like. So the kind of stuffed collections of either sculptures or Western works that we see completely go, but they would have been part of a certain logic of display and of spectating within very limited groups of that period. So I'm not really making a case that Stuart lacks refinement. I'm thinking about a certain representation of Stuart in his own time, which is why the figure becomes very difficult to resurrect. We know very little about his comportment. What this wayward going Hindu would have meant, we have very little. I mean, we know of so many people going native, but the fact that we have not a single portrait even of Stuart meant that it's very hard to know where did he transgress in a time when doing what he did was quite open to all, right? So that becomes a question that I was trying to pursue, and that the alleged lack of refinement. But on the other hand, the fact that these objects move and then get picked up by Christie's and then by other collectors and ultimately work their way, and it's today considered some of the finest specimens of early medieval sculptures from Bengal, Bihar, and Orissa, means that there's a latter-day, perhaps, artistic taste that may be today given to a person who was never given that status of either a collector or having taste, right? But nor the idea that what he was collecting was art. So interestingly, even the category of art is missing. But for Marble Palace, something that we don't consider art today, that was a category fully in place, not just in the 90s, but even into the early 20th century. You have paper actually now saying, this is art. This is where you can see the artistic taste of Hindus, right? So I'm thinking, therefore, of the contingent nature of both taste, but also categories of art and object collecting. So, I mean, that would be one way. And to say the logic is something that would be have to be reconstructed, right? And there is clearly a latter-day retrospective positioning of both these, which is what I end on, and a complete reversal of status, which I found both ironic, but also today historically completely set in place. This is bad Western art, copies of Western art, that is highest quality of Indian sculpture, which never was given that status in the time they were being collected, and which by sheer accident made its way to the British Museum. Chances of them being entirely dispersed in private collections would have been very high. So this is the contingencies, perhaps, the historical contingencies one is exploring.
Okay, so I go with David.
I was thinking that it would be good to add to this presentation a photograph of the hall in the British Museum where this work is displayed. And it's displayed, as I recall, in glass cases with rather old typed labels
that
haven't been changed.
No, this was written before, without going to London, so I couldn't get the British
And then you have pulled out of context, stolen from living temples, from what you say.
But to me, that history is erased. You don't talk about that.
But that's right. It's pulled out of the context, and it's not. These are religious objects, living religious objects. They're not like Egyptian things that were stolen by Napoleon and such. That are placed in a nude context. Part of the British Museum is one context. The other context is the auction house. And I was remembering a line that I once read in Marshall Solins, said that in a culture where every commodity is a fetish, every fetish becomes a commodity. One of the different key differences, it's sort of an obvious point, is that the art that is in Rajendra Moloch's house are not religious objects. They're perhaps Greek mythological objects and things like that. Maybe there are some Christian objects, but they were made as commodities in the first place, and that's not the case here. So part of the transformation
Would you like to take the three together?
Yeah, sure.
We have about 5 minutes, and keep your questions somewhat brief, okay? So that we don't get
Thank you, Tapati. I was piggybacking on Manon's question and Chandra's question combined to ask if there was, because what you haven't mentioned, and I'm wondering if this was the case in the minds of some of the collectors, was an aesthetic way of presenting. For instance, take for example this almost a continuous refining of the concept of the picturesque with the British. Was there a kind of, and in my mind, I'm making a comparison between, say, in Britain, the Wallace Collection and Sir John Soane's Museum, where the latter was collected all in one go, what we would call third-rate plaster casts now. Very valueless, in fact, at the time. But a lot of the collection was for theatrical effect, was for movement through the space, was a form of metaphors and ideas about himself as an artist, as an architect. Was the Marble Palace partly also seen as a theatrical collection? Was there a performance component to the way the material was collected and presented? Were the material, for instance, collected in bulk rather than slowly over time? So I'm just wondering if there are if there's perhaps a way of looking at the question from the point of view of the space itself and the display.
Mine is also another piggyback, I guess, in a sense. So I wanted to bring out the idea of, in terms of latter day delegitimizing or legitimizing these two collections, that one are authentic and not replicas, and the idea of replication or the concept of replication. These are authentic and have some sort of kind of empirical and artistic value later on, whereas copies lose that authenticity. And then again, where to situate maybe not theatricality, but also like actual plaster cast replicas, like of the Sanchi gates that the British made later on in the century, and the idea of replication.
Can I answer?
Yes,
please. Okay. Because I was going to forget. To quickly go back, I think you've hit the point where you talk about religious objects that become art, which perhaps had a certain quality, perhaps of antiquities, if we were to think of what antiquities mean in that time, and when Stuart is collecting, and which then get entirely removed from their prior religious context and become works of Indian sculpture in a museum. Now you're right, so therefore Stuart's collecting actually treads this thin line between objects that clearly he had a passion, perhaps even an interest in. And I like to think that this is a very interesting sliding line between the artistic and religious object that several collectors, perhaps. Stella Cramrish would keep objects in her own bedroom, fireplace. Havel would go into some transcendental thing when he saw collections. So I've often wondered, even latter-day people who had this deep mystical relationship with the objects they collected, how far that mode of the spiritual and transcendental would intervene, even in secular worlds of collecting. So Stuart is actually occupying that liminal place of what, and now they've been christened as art. Now, very interestingly, Rajendranath Mitra could collect without, as I said, ever giving up the sanctity of his Hindu self, because these were artworks. So he could maintain his Hindu pieties, his charities, and then cultivate his Western learning and taste as this layer that did not take away his status as a Hindu cultivated gentleman. And the fact that this was art collected. So you're right that none of this is coming to him as religious objects of another culture. So this is art collecting. And yes, to answer the question, that the copying of, or the collecting of copies, is a highly established procedure. So plaster casts are hugely in demand, copies are hugely in demand, and therefore this constitutes legitimate worlds of art collecting in Europe as much as in the empire. So I would like to therefore trouble the distinctions between the art and, you know, object collecting, and when, at which point does the object that is being collected move from being antiquities to becoming art, or from becoming art to now being seen as vestiges of, you know, the bad collecting or the replicas of another time. So yes. So I think Rajendranath Mitra was collecting art, and he had the confidence of that position in that time that he collected art, and it did not interfere therefore with his cultural identity, or maybe as what I would say his inner identity as a Hindu gentleman who maintained all his religious charities. With Stuart, there is a crossing of boundaries that is seen to be clearly troubling at different levels. On the display front, Chris, I think you're right that the question of the picture gallery and all the images that you see are of extremely crowded spaces. So that's the classic, where entire walls are filled with paintings. And if you go to the Marble Palace, that is precisely the form. It is clearly a defined form of this place which is meant to overwhelm. So you have layers of it. So if you look at all the idea of what the picture galleries are, it is that crowded space. Chances are he collected in lots, you're right, because all the collecting is done in his own lifetime. He's collecting bodies of engraving, maybe dispensing with some, maybe there is exchanging between collections, they travel between collections. And in terms of the performative, it's hard to know, but he saw this as a palace to the arts. He saw this as a place where he lived, but also where he entertained guests, and he wanted to train the taste of his own countrymen in this. That Europeans hardly visited it is interesting, clearly, but clearly banquets. So it is the background of a certain kind of publicness. And it's interesting that his descendants today are trying to recreate that kind of, that world where you invite people in to look at this and enjoy the background. So that's the closest I have. I would say that is where the logic of taste will also come in, that it was part of a certain display and a certain kind of sense of the publicness of this gathering, an exclusive public space which they would occupy. And yes, the replica. I think the Sanchi replica had as much status as a work of art as these replicas that travel. You're right, that if the Sanchi gateway could not travel, which you know that they wanted to take it away, so the Begums of Bhopal were being asked to gift it to the Paris exhibition, the war intervened, the Crimean War, and then the mutiny. And in the end, they mastered the plaster cast. And so Henry Cole's son became expert in making plaster casts of move. And the fact that the V&A had this huge cast gallery with monuments from all over the world meant that there was a big demand for casts. And for monuments which could not travel, the casts could. So similarly, if your European originals are in various collections, the copies and the casts travel. So I'm interested very much in the idea of the replicable object, which both in terms of the spread of taste and spread of pedagogy was extremely important. Half of India's museum collections would be built out of casts. So the copying of Indian architecture for India's own museums was deemed extremely important so that the originals could remain where they are.
Can you go
a little bit more? Okay, very good.
If there are more
questions. Yes, there is a question there and a question here. I think I see just these two. Should I take them together or shall I go?
Thank you so much. Like Shamok said, it has been one very nostalgic past 1 hour.
Shamok is just back from Calcutta. Very nostalgic. He was there just last month.
So I was more interested in the history of spectatorship. When does it open out into the public? Because I'm guessing not many Hindus would want to enter Hindu Stewards House for religious reasons. And again, the Mulikbari is a palace, and I don't know how much access to it people had. Of course, I remember when I was in middle school, we were taken on excursions to the Marble Palace. But back then, I'm not very sure. And then even when the museum opens, it's called the Jadugar, the House of Magic. It's more a question of wonderment and curiosity than, you know, the more stable, dignified thing of art appreciation. So I was just, I mean.
They call it now Shangrahalai.
But everyone, like, I grew up knowing it's called the Jadugar. And I thought it's some magician's palace or something.
It's the name.
So I was just wondering.
It's the Indian name for the museum.
So then when that shift from looking at curiosities, looking at freak shows, becomes this more stable, guarded discipline of appreciation.
I'll take the other and then answer. Yeah, I'll just echo everyone's thanks and nostalgia. but my question is maybe to go back to the very first images that you showed us. And I guess it's a methodological question because you've now been digging into this ethnographic method of working. And I was thinking that the two types of collections you've shown us are a wonderful mirror to each other. But in fact, the two architectures that you showed us have a kind of murkier relationship. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to that in the end, just the, you know, you've shown us a tomb that exactly, precisely locates this person not as a Hindu, and yet a collection that is suggesting something else. So, I mean, I'll just let you take what you will from that.
Yeah. Okay, on spectatorship and publics. You know, I've written on museum publics in the early period when British museum authorities are continuously bewildered by the fact that huge numbers of people visit museums, but there's already by then this idea of training publics, why visual educations are more important, so the idea of pedagogy through sight and through display. And they also, though, say that that the quantity runs contrary to qualities of viewing. And that's been, of course, a classic instance, that numbers did not automatically reflect on the pedagogic success and efficacy of the museum. So this has been, and it's a discourse that continues into the present, that we've never really had a cultivated museum going public, which is initiated into art viewing. It has been a late kind of coming of age, and whether it ever come of age, and that's why a lot of museum studies have returned to the question of what constitutes the museum's ideal publics and whether such ideal publics even exist, even in the so-called West, where there's a cultural museum going. Now, to answer your question, the wonder and the initiations into art viewing as were seen to be, today the quality of wonder is being recuperated, very actively recuperated, right? You want to bring wonder back into places where you have being trained. So you want to bring wonder back, you want to re-enchant the museum object, you want to bring it back to its context. So in a way, it seems that what Indian audiences never gave up on is something that is now being actively recuperated in terms of what will constitute public spectatorship. I worked on spectatorship much more in the context of a public festival where spectatorship is the essence of it all. For Marble Palace, it's hard to reconstruct. Now today, as you said, it exists as a curious museum space where school children are taken, where foreign visitors go to understand, to look at a little Europe in the heart of Chorbagan, and then, as you say, to travel across and see the home of the Tagores, you know, same time. So it exists. Now in Rajendra Mullick's time, you're right, it's an exclusive viewership, but he would have been cultivating. So it's part of the social worlds. So you think of him as member of the Asiatic Society, the Indian Museum, you know, studied in Hindu college, he has this range, so that his own education mirrors that of the museum. He's a natural history person, an ornithologist, a musicologist, and training. So if you look at the Indian Museum collection, it's precisely all of that, right? So it is this multiple worlds, it's this encyclopedic worlds of tastes and collecting that he represents, except that he's collecting both natural history and then into art and object collecting. His publics may not have been that dissimilar, except that the Indian Museum has opened up as a public space. And this is an exclusive space open to his society, the kinds he would invite in, so it wouldn't have been the masses. The masses would have come into the Thakur Dalan during the puja festivities and all, or during the larger benefaction, and they would not have been the public for whom his art was collected. His art was collected for a different public. That Europeans seldom visited it is something that they would have come for the banquets, but they would not have been interested in this as art of any kind, I presume, except that, you know, it was all around them. Why Indians, whether they would have gone to Hindu Stuart House, we're talking about an early moment when Wood Street is very much Chaiyappan, and it is, while you have Indians who are part of that, how far that world would have mingled, and yet Hindu Stuart is clearly engrossed. So this Sagar Island story is something that fascinated me. So obviously he's traveling all around. Who his Hindu wife is, we have no representation, unlike Hickey's Bibi. So it's again about who gets acculturated in a certain way to find their way into a series of representations. Hindu Stuart doesn't seem to have made the mark. And that is what has made me more and more interested of this man who's clearly invites so much interest today as this figure whose works find their way into the British Museum. Now, in terms of the two incommensurate worlds, both of collecting and architecture, you're right that this is clearly a white man's grave, turned oriental in a British cemetery. So in some ways, its curiosity is there, but its locatedness, as I said, within a cemetery where so much of the monuments are using this mix of styles, would not have made it so inapposite, except that he actually has sculptures incorporated in it. And the fact that this is the only one which is using Hindu architectural form rather than the larger Islamic kind of that we're traveling, which you see with the Charnak monument, the Hamilton, with Persian inscriptions on it. So that is what I would say. And architecturally, as I was, kind of telling Manan, what you see in the Marble Palace is again a template that is acceptable and almost has its own locatedness in that topography, and therefore I showed a lot of the others. They seem to belong to that location, however much they're clearly transplanted. And the fact that they use a lot of local masonry, a lot of the ornamentation and work is actually done locally, would again give it its own locatedness in that topography. So that would be one way of addressing that. Yes, there are incommensurate kind of complete different transpositions and travels I'm talking about, But I'm also talking about their rootedness in the spaces out of which they grew, even as they did. So Stuart's collection, like the Broadley collection, could have become part of a house museum, which many of them did. So the Broadley Museum, again, is an interesting one. There were several such museums of people who collected openly and where they were incorporated into homes. Begler's home was meant to have similar collections in Chuchura. Begler is an Armenian buried in Chuchura. So there would have been several such museums and where one could help oneself to archaeological material and have them as part of house museum, just as the Indian Nouveau Riche brought to your Western material. So I'm thinking of them as occupying certain defined social and cultural spaces. And yet, Stuart was pushing at that edge and continuously being pitched outside. That made him this figure, which is being recouped in terms of this great passage of material, very early collecting, and which the accident of how it got to the British Museum. But, and the other, the fact that there's so much European art material here, copies, and that it's all dispersed. That here you have, and you find them in Marwari residences now. When you travel to Kolkata's Marwari residences, they picked up a lot of this work which was thrown out. So, you know, as the zamindari houses all fell into dispute, lack of thing, and they could not maintain these collections. So actually when I was going in the 80s, I was told that into the 60s these collections existed. The art dealers were around, but they existed. And I've later found them in Marwari homes, several European art collections, so.
To what extent was collection viewed as violence? The question that I'm asking is, to what extent was collection viewed as violence, you know, particularly with regard to what you were discussing, you know, the removal of icons and images from the walls of temples. So it's really this kind of prehistory of collection that I'm very interested in. I'm thinking in terms of the, you know, sort of the novelistic tradition much later of the moonstone and how that enters into the Western imaginary. And what I think you were describing, you know, takes one back to an initial moment of violence, which then gets subsumed within these more aesthetic registers. So I just wondered if you had some remarks on how the perception of collection was at, you know, contemporaneously.
No, it's, of course, in terms of perception, in a latter-day context, a lot of collecting that happened, particularly in imperial context, have obviously been seen as acts of loot, appropriation, and illegitimate kind of taking away. And that's been the language in which the British Museum's halls, whether it be the Bergamon altar and all that, they were forcibly taken away. And of course that is in place. So therefore in some sense, one is going back to the very heart and root to say that all collecting is an act of dispossession and appropriation. And so whether it's anthropological object, as James Clifford will talk about, or whether a lot of people who will talk that, where do these objects belong? Question. But I'm also trying to think about the fact that objects traveled, collected, were appropriated, and that there is a long pre-colonial, pre-modern history, and which is what has been widely written about now, that you have circulations of objects through conquest, through gift, but also through just curiosity and collecting. So I like to think that yes, the violence is there, and Stuart's act of forcible appropriation from living sites seem to have rubbed, you know, things the wrong way. So both the European Orientalists and the Christian missionaries and Brahmin priests were talking about the forcible nature. But I like to think that a lot of this was happening because And if you think of several such collections that were gathering, then there is no perceived violence. In fact, collecting is completely a legitimate, a passion. Antiquarian collecting, travels, explorations are a driving passion. So if you place Stuart within a larger landscape of the transactions and travels of objects, it seems that he very easily fits into that. So I would actually, you know, slightly shift away from that question of obviously the violence to think about the acceptability perhaps of precisely these kinds of movements. Now, one will not talk about violence in terms of the money. Now, is there a violence in his acquiring these plaster casts and copies of marble statuary and paintings? No, I mean, it just seemed to be what, there's a huge market, there's a huge trade in these objects, and India is a site of that, precisely that depots of collecting and that is acquiring. Now you can think of similar kind of worlds that are opening up precisely in England where lots of Indian art objects are going. Mm-hmm. So there's open markets for dealing, collecting, auction houses. So if you go back to that, as I said, the deeply enmeshed histories through which objects travel, then one can no longer work with simple notions of violence and dispossession to begin with. And if you think of how much of antiquarian collecting was happening, often from piles of ruins, from disused temples, but occasionally, you know, the questions of worship is a very, something like the Didargan Jakshi, this classical piece, was being worshipped by Patna villagers when it's appropriated and put into a museum. So the fact that you needed to keep the claims of worship away is a long thing. So yes, long and short of it, I don't think Stuart was doing anything that violent, perhaps. No less or no more violent than what forms of collecting was going on in ways in which Indian objects would have been acquired.
Can I, as the moderator, make a little comment? I mean, because I'm completely outside of all this. I mean, if I were talking about, the trajectory of the colonial subject, right? And then I would say its relationship in the post-colonial situation and his son, and where is it in the city's life, and all that. That's not, I think, pertinent to this. But on the other hand...
No, it is pertinent. I wouldn't take away the colonial subjectivity at all.
No, but that's another side of the
organ. Sure.
But really, the one thing that I wanted to say was, you know, you were saying Calcutta, or Kolkata, whatever, I mean, that's not what I meant. I also say Calcutta. But the thing is, then it became India, if you distinguished between what happens in Bombay and what happens elsewhere. But I would have had a question about the role of Calcutta as such. I'm ignorant here, so my examples are just like individual examples. The only thing I've worked on is that Rani of Sirmaur thing. And Romila gave me a research assistant because I don't understand Hindi, certainly not Pari Hindi. So there, we were in the military museum in Patiala, which was a fantastic museum, because I was going in search of where I should go. And the guy was showing us the museum, the Calcutta Sela, brought from Calcutta, big looking glasses and motor cars and the Calcutta Sela. So finally this guy, Vagish Jha, the young Bihari, got so irritated, he says, "Meri madam bhi Calcutta Sela." She had to say, "My madam is also from that." So this whole business of the place of Calcutta, and then I went to the actual palace in Nahan, which was of course closed because of Padmini and so on, and I was very scared because they opened all those chains and I spent the night there. But it was exactly like what you were saying before education. But then what is the case? The case is that Rani of Sirmaur's son, he actually became an admirer of Bishop Shane and all that stuff. So I always have a question of this location of Calcutta in this, as a kind of mythic representation of a certain kind of colonial collector subjectship traveling. And the final thing that I wanted to say as a comment, I don't know of other kinds of these kinds of very unusual and almost silly defense of Hinduism. This is not Max Müller. This is not you know, those kinds of stuff. And I think that was the transgression. Because if one thinks about the people who very learnedly, you know, talk about the familial relationship, et cetera, that is a little bit different from, I haven't, you know, the 1802, those are, when he wrote his defense, those are anonymous. And I think that's really not the way in which, I mean, I'm thinking of the 1813, the Bishop of Calcutta, writing about the Hindu college, and kind of completely derogatorism. They're so stupid that the Hindus say that there are many different ways of worshipping and so on and so forth. We know that there is one way. I mean, it's written in this autobiography. So that it seems to me that the transgression was not the correct kind of defense. I think, you know, that's...
And he himself admits to that. What's very interesting, he says that it's the zeal of my need to defend, which often exceeds my actual knowledge of the subject. I mean, he actually says
that's what made him such a...
You know, just a brief reply. I would say that in the period that I'm looking at, Calcutta was perhaps a huge depot from which objects traveled, not just to all other parts of the empire, but into the other imperial depots of the East Indies. So I think Calcutta's place as this worlds in which huge numbers of objects were flying in, right through, I think, would be important. Its auction houses are famed, its dealers, its, and you know, in some ways, it seemed to have this very, very rich worlds of object flows and collecting, which, and where the museum only touches the tip of that iceberg, a lot of them was private. And the fact that right into the 20th century of huge spaces of private collectors makes one think of Calcutta's very important role as a kind of depot from which, particularly in terms of the trade in European objects, certainly they were being shipped in and then being moved to other spaces, I would say. Yes. So yes, good to think of Calcutta as the center of the world.
There you are, isn't it? Thank you.
Bye now.